students start the GDL without a training contract or any form of sponsorship, and sometimes even the LPC. They even do, you know, carry on after the GDL doing the LPC, self-funding it. Mm-hmm. It's a huge risk to take. What advice would you give to someone in that situation that hasn't, to get the most out of, mm-hmm. you know, the 2 years of doing that and trying to maximise their chances of getting a training contract?
I mean, GDL students tend to make the most out of their GDL. The GDL students here are really proactive and they're really engaged and they're really interested. So you'll put on, at the moment we're running a negotiation competition and it's full of GDL students. You know, they are really on the ball and they're really engaged, which is really good to see. And then you get to the LPC, and I think with the LPC, because it's the volume of work, it is hard work. Yeah. And, you know, whether you're on the full-time or the part-time you're working as well, so it's quite tricky. Generally you're working while you're doing the LPCs, it's quite tricky, and full-time as well, it's quite a lot of volume of work. I think though that the GDL students who've moved from the LPC cope much better, because the GDL is very overwhelming, and I think once they've coped with the GDL, the LPC is much better. So making the most out of that, I mean, here at BPP we have our careers hub, so our careers guidance here is just, I think it's amazing.
Yeah, it is. I can vouch for
yeah, it's amazing. And we do so much for students, so we put on loads of events for the students. We do law fairs, we have general talks from local lawyers, we work with BTSS, and we do the law firm walks, which is fantastic, because the students get to go to, I think, four firms in Birmingham, and they get to meet partners and associates, and they get treated really well. You know, they get tea and cake and biscuits. And I think the last time we went, the partners who were talking to the students were really engaged, they love it. You know, we were like, oh, I've got to get back, and they're like, oh, don't worry, just leave them all here. Like, oh, okay. See you later. So, you know, you kind of lead them to it. But, you know, you get that interaction with lawyers and with partners and people who are making the decisions, which is great. And then also we will do mock interviews. We go through CVs. We put on mock assessment centres. So we've got a mock assessment centre.
Yeah, I did that when I was doing the LPC mock interviews, mock assessment centres. It's so useful.
Yeah, and we've got another event coming up in March for the mock assessment centre. And we, at BPTC, we put the students through mock pupillage applications and interviews. So, and because we have links with all the local barristers chambers, we actually get people who are on pupillage committees to come in and do those interviews, because they're slightly different from a trainee interview. So you get that experience.
So lots of people, they have done their LPC already, they're paralegaling, and then they just can't make that transition from being a paralegal who's done the LPC to a trainee solicitor. Mm-hmm. So they're considering other routes to qualification. The most frequent one that I hear about is the Silex, and they think they want to cross-qualify and do that. Do you know much about that, and what would your advice be
to the paralegals? I've known a few colleagues who have done it that way. They've done their LPC and then gone through Silex. But we've got the SQE on the horizon as well. So those students may want to hold out for the SQE and what that holds for them. I think it depends on where they see their career going. Do they want to become a solicitor, or would they like to make their career as a paralegal? But if it's something, you know, if they want to become a solicitor and there is something going wrong between the LPC and the training contract, then I think they also need to look at their application process as well. Mm. And how they're going about getting into qualifying. So is there a reason why the firm they're working for won't give them a training contract? Are they applying internally? Is it just that firm doesn't take internal candidates as trainees, and so they only take outside hires? Or is there something else going on? So that could be something that particular future trainee could actually take control of and go and speak to, you know, their line managers, think about appraisals, you know, putting cards on the table. This is what I want. How are you going to support me doing this?
A lot of people have said that it's more so that they haven't gone to a Russell Group university, mm-hmm. or that they haven't got the entry requirements for a law firm, mm-hmm. and that's what's putting them down. So even though they've done the LPC and they might have got distinctions on their LPC, it's still the LLB part, and that stage of the process that's letting them down, or so they feel.
Okay.
And that's obviously something you can't really
even
change.
Even A-levels though, A-level requirements.
Really? Yeah.
Okay. So, and even though law firms say, oh, you know, that doesn't matter, mm-hmm. everyone's still looking at LPC, except,
yeah.
you know, your grade. I remember I applied to a really big international law firm. So I did go to a Russell Group University and yeah. I got 2-1, but it was a very low 2-1.
Yeah.
And I actually got like 40% in some of my modules. So it kind of brought it down a little bit. But I got through the application process,
yeah.
got all the way through to the assessment day. So I was like, oh, clearly they don't matter, like it doesn't matter. And then the first question I got asked in the interview part of the assessment day was, why are your grades so low at uni?
Well, yeah, some firms will ask you that. There are some firms I know that they are very strict on that, and it doesn't matter how many years experience or qualification you've got, it always seems to come back to this degree grade. In your experience, so I suppose in that sense, you know, firms are opening it up, they are being more inclusive, and I think with that kind of interview process, they are giving you the opportunity to explain. So it may be, okay, yeah, ideally we want this, you haven't got it, you've got everything else, can you explain this? And if it's a case, you know, if you say, yeah, I got a low T1 or I got a T2, however, I did this amount of volunteering, I was involved in this charity, yeah. I ran this, I worked part-time all the way through uni because I had to fund myself through university. If you can say all those sorts of things, or one of those things,
yeah.
you've already got an explanation for it, and actually the skills that you get from doing all those additional bits and pieces, and then if you've got additional placements and work experience already on your CV, then those grades shouldn't matter.
Do you think the legal profession should adopt something similar to what the accountancy firms have been doing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you hear of the big four, I think it's KPMG or PwC,
mm-hmm.
they've scrapped A-level requirements yeah. and things like that.
I think that's an interesting point, and I'm probably more leaning towards yes, I think that is something they should adopt,
yeah.
because, you know, it's difficult. People come from such different backgrounds and they have such different life experiences, and as I said already, I think it's a shame that someone can be tied to a particular grade. And, you know, sometimes it means that that grade is there because that person, sometimes a career choice is just not for that particular person, but that's not always the case. And so, you know, I think, and with the SRA and the SQE trying to open up the profession, well, this would be part of it.
The thing is, there's loads of partners in big international firms,
yeah.
and even some judges in the High Court and above that have two or thirds in their law degree.
Yeah,
so you're
yeah.
kind of like,
exactly.
Like, where did it come from? Because yeah. clearly it was fine when they were.
It was just to sift out all the applications, I guess.
Yeah,
competition is high, and so I suppose.
And then on top of that, you got psychometric tests.
Don't get me started.
If they're going to get rid of those types of entry requirements, then they'll have to have other requirements about what they're looking for. So, what else are they looking for if it isn't tying that person to that grade? And that's a whole new shifting of thinking, isn't it? So.
Thank you, Sarah, for joining us on this episode of Legally Brum. We hope you guys find the advice and what we've discussed useful.
Thank you very much. It's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. As always, thank you very much for having me.
Don't forget to like,
comment,
subscribe.